on my computer.
He'll do that during my Q&A. Okay. He's got it covered.
So what? If you would, that'd be great. And I'll just switch. I mean, what, is this your computer? Because I could just, do you have Keynote? Oh.
Got your thing plugged in. You're using a separate remote. Just come up here during the Q&A.
Okay. Okay.
What? That's not going to be at this.
It'd be lunch.
It's going to be at the lunch.
Lunch. Yeah. Yeah. No. People are just going to be sitting around eating, so it'll be fine.
I was just going to send him a text.
Oh, yeah, look at that. I just want to make sure he's good to go.
Wow.
He's good? All right. Well, I guess since you're all very quiet, I need to say hi. Morning, everybody. Hello. Welcome to Friday. Congratulations, you made it. Jesse, could you turn your mic off just in case there's...
Did you find your notes?
Okay. This is really sensitive this morning. We've got two keynotes coming up in a couple of minutes, but as usual, I want to give a quick overview of what's ahead for today. Going to throw a couple curveballs at you and go from there. So first off, our schedule. Again, looks rather familiar, a little bit truncated, but the thing to note is that lunch will take place right here. So in that 1 hour while you're with your cohorts, there's going to be a magical transformation, and this room is going to look completely different the next time you're in it, and there will be food available as well, which will be great. So that's the one big thing to remember for today, is don't go traipsing across campus to go look for food, because it's right here. And the second thing, I want to give you guys a homework assignment. Yeah. So as the director of hyperpedagogy, I think that it's kind of my job to encourage conversation and to encourage the conversation that you've had this week to continue in an online space. And behind me on the screen, I've got the most prominent calls for papers that we have on our site right now that most directly relate to the conversations that I've had and I've heard all week. And so I just want to drop a little nugget of an idea into your head. And if you've had this way, that sort of thing, and helped to shape some stuff. So anyway, your homework assignment is to consider whether you want to reach out to hybrid pedagogy. That's it. It was nice and simple. But I wanted to sneak that in before we left. I think with that, I'm going to hand it over to Jesse to introduce our keynote speakers.
Thank you.
Hello. I have the wonderful experience of having written out notes for doing this, and then I tucked them into this book. And when I opened the book, the notes were not tucked into the book. So luckily, I know the two people that I'm introducing extraordinarily well, or at least well enough to give a few minute introduction to them both. So the first person you're gonna hear from today is my colleague at University of Mary Washington, Martha Burtis. Martha Burtis is the director of the Digital Knowledge Center. She works on the fourth floor of this building. She is also a former member of the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies, and she was also at one point the acting director of the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies. The thing I will say about Martha, she has worked in education a long time in various different ways. And when I got to my position as the director of the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies, the thing that I knew more than anything else is that the space had been well honed for me in advance, well honed by many people. So I did not come into a space, and now I'm directing a basically all new team in the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies. But I don't feel like we're alone. I don't feel like we're setting out by ourselves because the ground has been tilled so thoroughly by people. And what I will say is that I feel more than any other person, when you walk into the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies and you see the work that we do, the person who we have most to thank for that is Martha. She is a person who tills earth. That is something that she does. And in many ways, she tills the earth and then moves away and lets things grow. I'm going to talk a little bit about her work in the Digital Knowledge Center. So the Digital Knowledge Center on campus is a peer tutoring center where students help other students learn how to do things with technology. One of our members of our team is Jess Reingold, who's sitting up here in the front. She is a former member of the Digital Knowledge Center. She started out as a peer tutor, and then she moved into the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies, moved from helping other students to helping faculty. The one thing that I could tell when I met her is that Jess had been thoroughly mentored into the work that she's doing with us now. And the person most responsible for that is Martha Burtis. The other thing I will say is that the space that we work in is very unique. The space we work in, the Digital Knowledge Center and the Division of Teaching and Learning Technologies, the space where faculty go for help and the space where students go for help, are separated by a wall of glass. So that any moment when you're in one space, you can see everything that happens in the other space. And these are two spaces where the door is always open between them. So when students are working with students, they're overhearing faculty working with faculty. When faculty are working with faculty, they're overhearing students working with students. This is something that was set up and architectured in advance. The space was built in order to facilitate that. There's never someone moving back and forth between the spaces, essentially allowing that to happen or encouraging that to happen. But I would say that that architecture is something that Martha has intensely helped to cultivate. This sense in which you trust your students so deeply that they can be privy to and overhear every conversation that the faculty have in the faculty development side. And so I want to thank her for helping make that space for me to come and work within. The next person I want to introduce is Sean Michael Morris. So each of them are going to give a short keynote. There will be a moment for Q&A between them. But I brought the two of these people together for this keynote. It was my choice to have them give this back-to-back keynote. The two of them didn't know each other when I came up with this wonderful grand plan. But they were, in my mind, my two secret weapons at this event. The two people who I work with most closely on a day-to-day basis that influence the work that I do most heavily right now. Sean Michael Morris is someone that I've known for 15 years. We have been teaching together for, I think, 14 years. Actually, we've known each other for 16 now, and we've been teaching together for 15 years. We really grew up together as teachers. So his pedagogy and my pedagogy are in each other's DNA. Impossible to extricate them. Often I'll find myself doing something in class, talking about how I teach, and I don't know if they're my words or his. He is currently an instructional designer in the Office of Digital Learning at Middlebury College. And his boss is sitting here in the front row, Amy Collier. There's a way in which I am very grateful to have my friend Amy Collier helping lead my other dear friend, Sean Michael Morris, because there's a way in which I feel like he is getting to step into a space that Amy has really carefully cultivated. She's relatively new at Middlebury College, but I feel like she brought with her the earth that she has been cultivating for many years. And so I'm so glad to have him to get to be able to work with her. Sean and I have told this story before, that Sean and I came up with the idea for Digital Pedagogy Lab walking around a parking lot in Silicon Valley. We were in Silicon Valley, we were in at Stanford, and we were really dissatisfied with the way education was being talked about, particularly with the way digital learning was being talked about. And I said, Sean, we need to go take a walk. This was about 10 at night. We had something that we had to do early the next morning. We walked around that parking lot probably about 10 times. We were walking around the parking lot with his husband, who had to sit through and listen to our machinations. The thing I will say about Sean is that Sean and I have been walking around parking lots for 15 years. That's the work that we do. The work that we do is pacing. It's constantly running ideas across each other to the point where we don't even know we're doing it. Every idea that I have is sort of part and parcel with the work that I do with him. I'm going to end my introduction by reading a short passage from my favorite book by Paulo Freire, which is Pedagogy of Hope. This is in the introduction to the book. So if you haven't read this book or aren't familiar with this book, I highly recommend it. It's a book where he returns to some of the ideas in Pedagogy of the Oppressed, which is the book that most of us have read or are familiar with, returns to some of the ideas and troubles them. And I think it's in this book where he really does the work that he set forth in that earlier volume, that work of introspection, that work of asking hard questions of even himself, which I think is crucial for us all to do. In the introduction to this book, he writes, "I am hopeful, not out of mere stubbornness, but out of an existential, concrete imperative. I do not mean that because I am hopeful, I attribute to this hope of mine the power to transform reality and by itself. So that I set out for the fray without taking account of concrete material data, declaring my hope is enough. No, my hope is necessary, but it is not enough. Alone, it does not win. But without it, my struggle will be weak and wobbly. We need critical hope, the way a fish needs unpolluted water. The idea that hope alone will transform the world and action undertaken in that kind of naivete is an excellent route to hopelessness, pessimism, and fatalism. But the attempt to do without hope in the struggle to improve the world, as if that struggle could be reduced to calculated acts alone or a purely scientific approach, is a frivolous illusion. To attempt to do without hope, which is based on the need for truth as an ethical quality of the struggle, is tantamount to denying that struggle is one of its mainstays. The essential thing, as I maintain, is this: hope is an ontological need, demands an anchoring in practice. As an ontological need, hope needs practice in order to become historical concreteness. That is why there is no hope in sheer hopefulness. The hoped for is not attained by dint of raw hoping. Just to hope is to hope in vain. Without a minimum of hope, though, we cannot so much as start the struggle. But without the struggle, hope, as an ontological need, dissipates, losing its bearings, and turns into hopelessness. And hopelessness can become tragic despair. Hence the need for a kind of education in hope." The last thing I want to say about these two people is that Sean and Martha are the most deeply skeptical people I know. And they are also the most hopeful. Thank you.
I thought I'd start today by telling you a little bit about myself, because while some of your faces are familiar, I don't know most of you, and I doubt that you know very much about me. So by now you know my name, and you know from my introduction that I run the Digital Knowledge Center here at the University of Mary Washington. That's the Digital Knowledge Center. We provide peer tutoring and consulting to our students working on digital projects and assignments. But I want to tell you a few other things about myself. I attended this school, although at the time it was known as Mary Washington College, and I graduated from here 20 years ago this past May, and I received a BA in English. And when I graduated, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I was going to get a PhD in early modern literature, and eventually I was going to get to teach, hopefully at a school just like this. Instead, a couple of other things happened. The year I graduated from Mary Washington in 1996 was pretty close to the year that the web broke big. And I discovered it between my junior and senior years in college during a summer class in medieval literature, of all things. And my primary use of it my senior year of college was as a research tool for debate. I was on the debate team that year. And by the time I had graduated, I was thoroughly charmed by it. And what I actually ended up doing the year after I graduated was going to work at one of the finest places in the world that I thought was really going to set me up for this career that I wanted in early modern literature, the Folger Shakespeare Library, right up the street in Washington, D.C. I was a program assistant for the Folger Institute, which runs seminars and workshops and summer institutes for faculty and postdocs in early modern studies. And I spent a lot of time around mid to late career scholars who were fully and meaningfully employed in wonderful teaching positions. And I spent a lot of time around struggling graduate students who were working construction to make ends meet. And I luckily enough in my job got to really work on the web and do stuff on the web. And the confluence of these two things, falling in love with the web while falling out of love with the idea of never getting a job, took me down a completely different path. I ended up moving to New York City and getting a master's degree in instructional technology from this place, Teachers College at Columbia University. I lived there for about a year, and while I was there, I got really sick. And I eventually moved back because I got to a point where all I wanted to do was punch the tourists on the stairs who would stop to look around when I was trying to walk to my job. And I realized I was turning into someone I didn't want to become. So I moved back to Virginia. And a few months after completing my thesis and getting my degree, I got my very first job in instructional technology, and it was right back here at Mary Washington College. And I was hired as an instructional technology liaison. I like to joke that the hardest thing about that job was learning how to spell liaison. I still can't do it. I supported the faculty in fine and performing arts right up the hill from this building, it was 2001, and I loved the faculty, and I loved the students, and I hated my job. At that time, in my job, I was basically providing technical support for faculty in their departments. So I was fixing printers, and I was setting up lab computers, and occasionally I got to tell a faculty member something about PowerPoint or Excel or Word. We had one tool in our instructional technology toolset at the time, Blackboard. And faculty primarily used it to distribute digital files, email students, and post their grades. So that was my first full-time professional job in instructional technology. I wasn't using anything that had to do with my degree. And my boss at the time suggested that professional development, I consider becoming an Apple certified technician. This was in pre-Genius days. So I did work with great people in my department, and I loved the faculty, and I loved the students, and I loved this place, and I still do. I would like to say that lots of faculty were coming to me to help them think through how they could use the web to transform their classes and their teaching and their students' experience, and that I was regularly inundated with bold and imaginative ideas, and that I felt capable and empowered enough to partner with them on these adventures. But I felt neither capable nor empowered, and the truth is, neither did they. When I was working at the Folger and when I was in graduate school in the late 90s, the web seemed like a place of infinite possibility, a great democratizing force and a space in which anyone could build themselves something remarkable. Now, I was younger then, and I was naive. And the history of the web is more complex than that, and technology nostalgia is like any other nostalgia. It is colored and softened by the long lens of the future. But I do remember, for example, a tool I played with in graduate school, this would have been maybe in the spring of 2000, that allowed multiple people to leave public annotations on a website. And when I used it, it felt like I was connecting with people in a way that had never done before. It felt like magic. And it didn't work very well. The truth is that the bandwidth and the code hadn't caught up with our imaginations. But the web was this powerful force that was washing over us. And we were all in every field, in every industry, in our personal lives, in our professional lives, we were trying to stay afloat and figure out what it meant. And it seems only reasonable to assume, no, not reasonable, it seems impossible to not expect that in the domain of education, a domain that is entirely about creating and building and sharing knowledge and learning, that this new force of creation and knowledge sharing would be fully and authentically realized. How on earth could it not be? How could we all not see the power that this new medium was affording us and not be drawn to it in every way? And most importantly, how could we not see that, in fact, it was our job to shape the new medium and to teach the world about what it meant as a platform for transformational learning, as a space for public research and dissemination of information, as a place for collaboration on scales never seen before, and yet. So what happened? So I have a few theories. I think that the web hit us at a really critical moment in higher education when we were already struggling with doing our work less like schools and more like businesses. And the tech industry and its vendors had already begun to infiltrate us with promises of how technology would help us achieve that goal. We'd already bought into student information systems, which have now become everything information systems. And with the promise of those systems came the promise of lots of data, which would allow us to become more efficient and more streamlined. And the first LMSs were actually built in schools. Most LMSs come from schools, often under the guidance of faculty. And I like to imagine that those people were as charmed as I was about the affordances of the web for teaching and learning. And I want to believe that their intentions were really good. But what they focused their efforts on was building systems for disseminating content, systems with common interfaces, systems with standard tools, systems that could integrate with other systems to make our work more efficient, our experiences cleaner, and our teaching and learning, as a result, more sterile. What if the early web adopters in higher education had imagined domain of one's own instead of course in a box? And why didn't they? In part, this question is about why our systems use courses as a unit of measure instead of people. And the answer to that is really complex and stretches far back into the history of education, and it's beyond the scope of my 25-minute co-keynote. But suffice it to say that courses have long been the way we have measured our institutions and the way we've organized our administrative processes. We understand ourselves and what we offer to students through the unit of the course. But I would argue that with the greater adoption of administrative systems in higher ed, we doubled down on that unit of measure. And with the LMS, we did something even bigger. Because even if we had decided for centuries that in our schools the course would be how we standardized administration of our schools, we didn't systematically believe that courses themselves were standardized. We valued the notion that within one professor's course, she has the freedom to enact and explore the topic at hand using the pedagogies of her own choosing. And by extension, presumably the tools and technologies of her own choosing. But when the LMS goes beyond merely providing administrative and management features and instead is offering features designed, albeit perhaps badly, to build community, share information, and collaborate with others, it is obviously influencing pedagogy. I don't think we acknowledge this nearly enough when we talk about the technologies we use in education. We like to think that a tool is easily defined by its basic functionality: discussion board, wiki page, synchronous chat, quiz builder. But all of these tools are, of course, far more complex than that. They've been designed and coded and engineered by companies to provide functionality in particular ways. And that design and code guides our students and our experience through their use. Imagine, if you will, if someone told you that from now on, when you conduct a classroom discussion in your room, you are bound by a series of rules, procedures, and steps. And you must follow those at all times, and everyone else at your institution must also. From now on, every classroom discussion at your school must be conducted using these same rules, procedures, and steps. If you don't like them, you'll have to wait and see if the next update to them addresses your concerns. You would probably balk at this suggestion, and you should. But rules, procedures, and steps are exactly what code defines. And when we fail to acknowledge this, we fail to see the pedagogical power that technology and the LMS can have in our classroom. So the LMS underscores and further codifies a set of beliefs and values. Courses should be used as a unit of measure to more efficiently track and administer the business of higher education. And within those courses, we should build standard interfaces, provide standardized features and tools, and promote among our students the expectation that their experiences from one course to next will be standard. Why else did we not end up with courses in boxes? Why else did we end up with courses in boxes instead of domains of one's own? There are actually some pretty good practical reasons why domain of one's own didn't exist in 1996. Domains cost a bundle back then, and procuring them wasn't straightforward. But lots of schools had what we now affectionately refer to as tilde spaces. Why didn't we end up with tilde spaces of one's own? Well, we actually did. Most schools, including this one, provided students with their own tilde space where they could post HTML documents. And some faculty did use these spaces for students to publish on the web. But as the web evolved, our institutions didn't keep up with evolving these spaces. We didn't add scripting or database features. And so the spaces became technically irrelevant and obsolete. And instead of putting our resources and our skills and our imaginations into figuring out what those spaces could become for teaching and learning, we began spending a lot of money on learning management systems and other educational technologies. So now we have a perfect storm. We've doubled down on courses and the LMS. We've bought into the notion of what technology afforded us for teaching and learning with standardization of experience and pedagogy. And we've abandoned the nascent spaces that might have let us continue to explore the web as a flexible, open, and powerful platform for teaching and learning. And we've spent so many years going down this path that there are now powerful monetary investments and administrative processes and expectations pounding on our backs, pushing us further and further. How do we make it stop? To answer this question, I need to pick up my story. So after working at Mary Washington for about 16 months, I got married and I moved out west to Montana, where my husband was getting his graduate degree. And when we decided it was time to move back east to be near our families, I discovered that my old job, which had been frozen for budgetary reasons right when I left, had just been reposted. So I applied and I got the position. And in August of 2004, I moved back to Fredericksburg into the exact same office I had vacated 2 years before. It was the same job, but it wasn't at all. A lot had changed at Mary Washington. We were a university now. My department was under new leadership too, and we began, in that first year I was back, experimenting with open source platforms. During that time, every member of my department, DTLT, got a domain name and open source web hosting, and we went from having one tool in the tool shed to having a rainbow of tools. The tools themselves were open source applications. Applications for creating websites in many different flavors, blogs, discussion forums, media galleries, wikis, even open source learning management systems. And in addition, we were working in an open source space where, if we wanted to, we could learn to build our own tools. At the very least, we could adapt the tools we were using. Suddenly, the web felt accessible to me in a way it had never been before. I had complete control over a slice of it, and I dove into understanding how it worked. I started my own blog, as did all of my colleagues. I began experimenting with an open source community building platform as a way to connect our department, since at the time we all worked in different buildings. And we began building custom learning spaces for courses based on our partnerships with faculty. That wasn't timed properly. For me, working in open source made possible all the things I had imagined back in the 90s, and it challenged all of those beliefs and values that the LMS underscored. It was possible to build learning environments that empowered students and not to the detriment of the course. I could create learning environments in which the interfaces, tools, and features were customized to the needs of the professor and students, and there was simply no reason to assume that the experience from one course to the next needed to be standardized. Open source was infused with a different set of values and beliefs: co-construction, iteration, fast prototyping, extensibility, and, well, openness. It was probably within 3 years that we began to ask the question, what if every faculty member and student had this, their own domain name, their own web space to build what they want or they need? What would happen and what would change? It took another 6 years before domain of one's own was fully realized at Mary Washington. And during that 6 years, we continued to build an experiment. The first great experiment was UMW Blogs, our institutional blogging system, which debuted in fall of 2007. And in that 9 years, it has almost 13,000 users and now contains 11,000 individual sites. So what exactly is UMW Blogs? Well, first and foremost, it is WordPress, an open source content management system, but a special breed. Specifically, it's WordPress multi-site, which allows us to administer a single core code instance that governs as many individual WordPress sites as we need. In other words, we only have to upgrade it in one place. Within that system, we can then make plugins and themes available to users. And themes let users change the way their sites look, and plugins let them change the way they behave. This extensibility aspect of WordPress is why it has, for me, become a game changer. When faculty or students have something they want to build on the web, I can almost always figure out a way that they can achieve it with WordPress. Students have used UMW Blogs to create literary journals, surveys of properties around Fredericksburg, build online exhibits, connect with the authors of the works that they are reading, publish their poetry, develop in-depth online resources, and of course, blog. UMW Blogs allows us to give any member of the UMW community a WordPress site, really as many WordPress sites as they want, but we still control the underlying code. We decide what plugins and themes are available, and we're the ones who decide when upgrades happen. In 2011, I became part of another project to push, that pushed our thinking. That spring, I was scheduled to teach a computer science class in digital storytelling alongside Jim Groom. Jim had taught the class face-to-face for two semesters, but he wanted to do something bigger that spring, and he suggested that we open the course up and allow anyone on the web to participate. And I agreed. So let me back up. I have to tell you something else. That section of Computer Science 106 that I taught in spring 2011 was the first time I had ever taught. After years of working as an instructional technologist and web developer at schools, I had finally gotten up the guts to teach. And of course, the first time out of the gate, I was teaching it with Jim Groom on the open web for the whole world. This, of course, was the birth of DS106, the digital storytelling community, and I want to tell you about a few pieces of that that were game changers for me. Thank you. First, we decided that every student at UMW participating in DS106 had to get their own domain and web hosting for the class. We knew they were going to be publishing their work on the web, but UMW blogs wasn't enough. They had to fully own their own space. In fact, owning that space and building out their digital identity and understanding the ensuing narrative would become a crucial, critical piece of the DS106 experience. And this notion is one of the ideas at the heart of DS106 and Domain of One's Own. The other thing we did in DS106 was massive syndication. Every participant, whether at UMW or elsewhere, has their individual blog syndicated into the main DS106 site, where posts can be filtered and viewed by specific categories and tags. We'd been playing with syndication for quite some time at UMW, in UMW blogs, but never on this scale. And we'd never brought together a community quite like this before. Posts from my students were interwoven with Jim's students and with those of our open participants all over the world. This commitment to massive syndication and massive openness became a core value of DS106, and the dynamic of having open participants in the mix with our UMW students changed the nature of how we and our students thought about teaching and learning. My colleagues in the DS106 community from other institutions often helped my students or gave them feedback before I did. In future iterations of the class, we've had our students collaborate with open participants on large projects, like producing a radio show, as well as participating together in synchronous spaces, like Google Hangout or Minecraft. UMW students in DS106 come away with an understanding that there's absolutely nothing standardized about their experience. They're also usually really exhausted at the end of the semester, and they hate me a little, but they get over it. Right off the bat in DS106, we knew we wanted to turn the idea of media assignments on its head. Jim, in teaching the course face-to-face, had 10 to 12 specific assignments that he had had the students work through, grouping them around particular media genres or storytelling approaches. We decided early on that we wanted to blow that model up. And in the vein of massive openness, we built an assignment bank that allowed anyone to submit an assignment idea. They provide a name, a description, an example, and a difficulty rating, and we publish it on the assignment site. When we teach DS106 on a weekly basis, we tell people how many stars of work they need to complete, and our students get to choose which assignments they do to complete it. When they finish an assignment, we publish it on our own site, they publish it on their site, and through the magic of syndication, we pull it onto individual assignment pages so future visitors can see how others have gone about completing it. As of today, we have almost 1,000 assignments in the assignment bank and 11,000 submissions. I mentioned DS106 here because it was such an important stop on the road to Domain of One's Own, and it validated for us that students were capable of working on the open web, building and managing their own spaces, and it confirmed for us that we needed to make Domain of One's Own happen on a larger scale. In fall of 2012, we began to pilot Domain of One's Own, and fall 2013, the project was fully funded. Today, any UMW student can get a domain name for the duration of her time at Mary Washington and open source web hosting, and it's available to faculty and staff as well. I'd like to suggest four goals that are embedded in Domain of One's Own, but I have to tell you I haven't run these by Jeff McClurkin yet, so these ideas are my own, not the institution's. Number one, provide students with the tools and technologies to build out a digital space of their own. Help students appreciate how digital identity is formed. Provide students with curricular opportunities to use the web in meaningful ways, and push students to understand how the technologies that underpin the web work and how that impacts their lives. You'll notice that only one of these goals speaks directly to teaching or curriculum. And I sometimes get pushback when I talk about these other three. What does digital identity have to do with college? Why do our students need to muck around in the code? Why can't they use commercially provided tools like WordPress.com or Wix? Don't they already have spaces of their own on Facebook and Tumblr and Twitter? Why do they need this one? I frankly find these questions perplexing. It seems to me that the web is the single most powerful media environment to ever exist in our history. I've lived through the last 20 years, and I can't even wrap my head around the changes it's enacted on me personally, much less on us culturally. For most of this time, in higher education, we have sat back on our heels, locked in our boxed courses, convincing ourselves that the web has nothing really to do with us. It has everything to do with us. Here's a thought exercise I sometimes give my students. How many times a day do you use Google to search for something? Do you even think about it? I don't. I once lost my glasses and tried to Google them. I really did. So you Google something and you get a page of results. And how often do you stop to think about what those results mean, where they came from, what you're seeing, and what's being hidden from you? Who decides this? We all know there's an algorithm behind search. Was it written on stone tablets and handed down from on high? Here's another thought exercise. I have a Facebook account. If I go to Facebook, the profile editor wants me to answer lots of questions. Where do I live? Where do I work? What are my skills? What's my favorite quote? What are my political or religious views? Why does Facebook want to know these things about me? Does it want to be my friend? Does it actually care? Google and Facebook are cornerstones of the web. They give us information, and they take information from us, and they use that information. They control it. They decide what we see when we see it. Facebook has run experiments to try and change how we feel. Google can, from one day to the next, drastically alter what the entire world sees when it searches for a presidential candidate, a pharmaceutical drug, a breaking news item. Our students drift on the web from site to site, search engine to social network. They pull open their phones, they snap a picture, they believe it will disappear in a few seconds. They don't understand how any of it works, how it's built, who controls it, who codes it, and who changes that code and why. We can give them opportunities through projects like Domain of One's Own to begin to think critically about what they're doing online, not through either the fear-mongering that they've experienced in high school or through some Pollyanna-ish rhetoric about how the web is the ultimate democratizer, but rather by asking them to make things on the web, grapple with how those things are managed and controlled, and consider how what they see on the web shows up on their own screens. I want to end with a question someone asked me the other day, and basically this person wanted to know how to explain or sell Domain of One's Own to administrators who are concerned about what happens when it breaks. And my response was, you tell them, good, it broke. And that's kind of glib, but it's also true. I can guarantee that if you have a domain of your own, stuff will break. It will break in some predictable, easy to fix ways, and probably in some totally weird, tearing your hair out kind of ways. Your students will experience this too, and it will be frustrating and terrible, and it will not be standardized or easily consumed. It will not be easily defined or put in a box. It will be gloriously and awfully messy. And you may have to switch directions or gears, and I hope that when you do, you talk to your students about what happened and why it happened, and that you work together to try and figure that out. And I hope that your students come away from it just a bit more sure of how things work and how things break, and just a bit more curious about how to make things and how to break things. Thank you.
We're going to open it up for just a few questions, and we'll run around with the mics. And there will also be time at the end to do a joint Q&A with Sean and Martha.
I'm not an academic, but I'm going to do what academics do, which is I'm going to say something and not ask a question.
I love it.
And I'm just going to say, Martha, that you're my hero.
Thank you.
So I really identified with your story because I'm getting ready to teach for the first time and I'm doing a domains project. So, I mean, I'm going to ask a big question, yeah. Right? Like just right outside the gate, do you have any kind of advice for me? I'm considering doing kind of like a mother blog where, yeah. You know, the RSS will kind of bring in everybody's feeds and each one of the students will have their own domain. I'm really conscious, especially after this, about letting the students kind of choose their identity mm-hmm. and, you know, not necessarily making them think really right. hard about using their real names, that kind of thing. I don't know. What do you think? You got some advice?
So if you had asked me a few months ago, I would have told you the best advice was to get Jim Groom to teach with you. No, that's not true. I mean, it is and it isn't. Teaching with Jim Groom is wonderful and really, really hard. But so I guess what coming away from that first experience that I had teaching this in such a tremendously vulnerable and open way, my very first teaching experience, which in many ways teaching with domain of one's own is about being okay with making yourself vulnerable and about asking your students to be vulnerable and understanding that if you're going to do that, you have to have their back every step of the way because that vulnerability comes, that's difficult. Mm-hmm. They haven't been asked to do that before. So I would say go into it with your eye on the next thing. Be really gentle with yourself in terms of your expectations and understand that at any moment, it's okay to switch gears and to try something new and to let your students guide you and to rely on other people to help you with that. In many ways, because my first teaching experience was teaching DS-106 in this massive open thing, I said, you know, other people would teach my students before I even had a chance to. And so I never had that experience of having to give up control. I never had control. I was teaching with Jim. But I think that was really healthy too. And I think if you can approach your own experience that way, of don't come at it from an expectation that you need to have control. Give yourself permission to give up that control early on and to let it take you where it will.
I appreciate that, thank you.
Other questions? Okay.
Super sensitive mic. I'm curious if you have any sense of whether the students are carrying this on after they graduate?
Sure, yeah. So so just to give you a little bit of idea of how this works at Mary Washington, students are, they have their domain and their web hosting for the duration of their time, from when they sign up until they leave. And then we do give them kind of a grace period of about 6 months where they can migrate off of our system. So we don't kind of push them out of the nest the day after graduation. Because moving off can be a little bit daunting. And then their options there are really up to them. It's entirely fine for them to say, I did that, I built it, I'm done with it, I'm leaving it behind. If they want to take it with them, they can take over ownership of their domain and they can go and find their own commodity web hosting and we give them some various options and advice about how to do that and then information about how to take over control of their domain and their web hosting. I will say that we haven't done a fantastic job yet of tracking how many are leaving, but that's something that we need to do a better job of. But what I will tell you is that I know anecdotally from talking to the students who keep it, that this is something that the ones who keep it, it's because it has become part of who they are. And they're not okay with the idea of losing it. And so working in the DKC, we're increasingly having students reach out to us after they graduate saying, hey, I just realized I built all this stuff. What's going to happen? What do I do? And so trying to give them as much support and advice about a clear and easy path forward is really important. But I will also say this, and this is something that used to come up in DS-106, even before Domain of One's Own existed. Jim used to kind of really push students to migrate whatever they had done in DS-106 to even something like UMW Blogs or another system. And we kind of grappled with this because some students at the end of DS-106 would just, they'd turn it off and they didn't want to. And I actually have absolutely no problem with that because I think our job is not to tell students what they have to do. I think our job is to teach students what their choices are. And then they need to make choices. And those choices need to come from being informed as opposed to just doing what they were told or doing what their friends are doing. And sometimes turning it off is the right choice for a student, for whatever reason. And I think that if you're truly empowering students, you have to be okay with that choice. And you have to actually realize that that choice isn't a bad result, necessarily.
I'm going to use that as a really great segue to shift towards Sean.
Yes.
And then we will bring Martha back up at the end for a bit of joint Q&A. Thank you.
There I am. Can you guys hear me okay? Oh, wow, this is interesting. This is the first time I've worn one of these little things. It's like my voice, but coming back to me. It's very interesting. I usually do my best to stay quiet. It's actually, as Jesse said, only on his insistence that I'm standing up here at all. It's not that I don't like to talk. My family would tell you that I like to talk a lot. It's that when I listen, it's actually that when I speak, you listen to me. You listen because I have a podium, I have slides, I have the script in front of me. All your training tells you to listen to me. I do my best to stay quiet because when I'm quiet, I can hear you. And it's you I'm interested in. Your stories, your efforts, your insights. Over a year ago, I was having dinner with a friend of mine. He does social justice work related to small businesses, unions, minority business owners, underdeveloped neighborhoods. It's very worthwhile work. He told me that when he sits down with a group he's facilitating, made up largely of people of color or LGBTQ business owners, he starts by saying that everyone has stories they want to tell, but at this table, everyone is equal. That, of course, is not quite right. We've heard something like it before. It's the All Lives Matter argument. That all stories are equal, all stories matter. This is not how we get to hear the stories we need to hear. This is not how we amplify silenced voices. We amplify silenced voices by listening. We make by making space for them to speak. Not safe space necessarily, but daring space. Because actually, it's never safe to speak. And that's something that's worth saying about domain of one's own. A space on the web is a platform, a space for expression, for speaking, for creating. This week, the intro track has been working on their own domains, picking through what they know and what they don't know, trying to decide what to say there. And it's hard work. It's good work, but it's hard work. A lot like learning. I would echo Martha's question. Why did we end up with courses in boxes instead of domains of one's own? And if I'm honest, I blame instructional design. For too long, really, since its inception, instructional design has been built upon silencing. Instructional design generally assumes that all students are duplicates of one another. Or as Martha said, standardized features, standardized courses, standard students. Despite any stubborn claims to the contrary, instructional design assigns learners to a single seat, a single set of characteristics. This is for efficiency. But it enacts an erasure that, taken to the extreme, is unconscionable. To understand how that erasure occurs, we'll take a little look at the origins of instructional design. These are not changing. A power button. Technology. Okay, sorry about that, guys. Did you want to see the other slide? That's cute. Okay. I have written that today most students of online courses are more users than learners. The majority of online learning basically asks humans to behave like machines. This comes out of the fact that most online courses today are written around instructional design principles, which in turn were written around research in computer-aided instruction, or CAI. The relationship fostered by instructional design is not one of learner to learning, it's one of learner to mechanized instruction. I say this now, even as I bear the mantle of instructional designer for the Office of Digital Learning at Middlebury College. Good. A very long time ago, I wore that same mantle, or a similar one, for a small startup in Colorado whose nearly sole client sold courses to human resources administrators in the banking industry, and whose primary foundation for instruction was Bloom's taxonomy. Quite literally, software for corporate training was designed around the cognitive domain of the taxonomy of educational objectives. All learning in this case boiled down to five component objectives: remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating. And every course we wrote scaffolded learning along the ladder of these objectives, almost always stopping at application level work, doing what you've learned to do. Because that's all that was expected of our clients' workers. To be considered knowledgeable, all you needed to do is remember what you learn, understand what you learn, apply what you learn. Remember, understand, apply. Knowledge. But Bloom and his team defined knowledge as involving the recall of specifics and universals, the recall of methods and processes, or the recall of a pattern, structure, or setting, which means that by this definition, knowledge is the same as recall. Remember, understand what you remember, and apply what you remember. New experiments in digital learning, personalized learning, adaptive learning, competency-based learning, raise the banners of education revolution, much as the MOOC did. But what principles are they founded on? What relationship do they encourage between learner and learning, or learner and computer? In many cases, the methodology hasn't evolved from a critical pedagogy, but rather from the same CAI principles of traditional instructional design. What's really scary here is that due to the ubiquity of the LMS at colleges around the world, classroom teaching has started to change. Martha painted a really scary picture of what that would look like, but that's actually happening. CAI has entered into the classroom, turning students into pigeons, teachers into dumb terminals. Now we must produce quantifiable data for our on-ground teaching, designing in-person learning with the same foundations as online learning, when online learning has yet to do it right. See, knowledge isn't the same as recall. It's more than that. For starters, we know that learners can create knowledge, that they can be their own best resources outside of a teacher or content. If we look at complexity theory, for example, we discover that knowledge is the result of inquiry, experimentation, feedback, and emergence. As well, the relationship of the learner to the computer can be more nuanced than the kind of banking education that CAI demands. Seymour Papert offered this challenge. Most honest schoolers are locked into the assumption that school's way is the only way because they have never seen or imagined convincing alternatives to impart certain kinds of knowledge. Almost all experiments in purporting to implement progressive education have been disappointing because they simply did not go far enough in making the student the subject of the process rather than the object. And the hard truth is that instructional design, teaching, needs to start imagining convincing alternatives. It needs to go far enough. In contrast to this, B.F. Skinner, one of the granddads of educational psychology, wrote that The application of operant conditioning to education is simple and direct. Teaching is the arrangement of contingencies of reinforcement under which students learn. And when you search operant conditioning in Flickr, because of course, why wouldn't you do that? You get this. That? That's a dog. That's not a student. Matthew Kruger Ross writes, computer-aided instruction redefined learning as driven by clear and concise objectives that could be easily quantified and measured. And quantifying learning, that thing that administrations want us to do and for which so many functions of the LMS exist, depends on right answers. And right answers are based on recall of content. You remember to sit, or you don't. You remember to stay, or you don't. This is learning reduced to a game of Simon. Ira Shore writes, at the heart of my lecture was my search for a presentation that could unveil a compelling reality to the students. We must ask, is instruction bent on this same unveiling? Can a course whose content circles around objectives, assessments, and recall pull back the curtain on anything? Can it, as Paulo Freire suggests, invite learners into an epistemological relationship to reality? Do all our lectures reveal a compelling reality? Does this keynote? There's something insidious about the way we talk about learning, something insidious in the keynote format. Something pretty horrendous happens when we assume all ears are the same ears, and that all ears are trained to listen in the same way to the person at the podium. When we do that, we're silencing voices that might speak. And we do this because the alternative is too complex, too difficult. Oh, that's what I just said. Forgot to switch. Dee Watkins, a writer for Vice and Salon, wrote about a visit to his 13-year-old nephew's school. The nephew was having trouble communicating with the teacher, and he was pretty sure he could help out. His observation when he arrived was, this school seemed like a jail, and level 2 was the psych ward. Students bolting up and down the hallways, desks taking flight, a trail of graded and ungraded papers scattered everywhere, fight videos being recorded on cell phones, rich homie Kwan turned to the highest level, crap games and card games going down everywhere, all bottled up and sealed with that same shitty smell, so bad it was loud enough to hear. A shit stench I hoped wouldn't stick to my flannel. So this is it, my sister says, with an uneasy smirk. This is her only option. According to Watkins, this scene is too common in inner city schools. It's a deeply troubling scene, and one that threatens to rip us out of the joy and collegiality we've been feeling this week. But I offer it because I don't believe we can afford to silence any voices. I offer it because when we're talking about designing for outcomes, designing for skills, or designing for emergence, we are not talking about this. And we must. Because where is learning happening in that scene? What good are objectives and assessments going to do for those kids? Are the answers that Vygotsky offers, that Skinner offers, or even that Freire offers going to help us here? There is no inner city LMS. And if we make the mistake to think that we don't teach inner city kids, let me remind you that children grow to be adults, and they carry with them the circumstances under which they receive their education. Your students have fought. Your students have hidden from bullies. Your students have been hungry. Your students have passed for straight. They've held their tongues, and they've been broken. And in many cases, the students you work with have had to subvert a system that sought to oppress them in order to make it to your classroom or to show up as a name inside your LMS. Learning is a subversive act. It is not an act of recall. It's not an act of imitation, regurgitation, or repetition. It's never passive. Learning is a subversive act. And so must teaching be. Not out of compulsion, but from logical necessity. If learners are to move from what we know into what we do not yet know, from recall to emergence, or more importantly, from oppressed to liberated, then teaching must also deal in what we do not yet know. It must deal in the stuff of real struggle. Emergence isn't pretty. It's not a flower opening. It's rough, complicated, unruly, embarrassing, and in that way, full of wonder. To teach in a manner that respects and cares for the souls of our students is essential if we are to provide the necessary conditions where learning can most deeply and intimately begin. Learning is not safe. In fact, to learn is to take a risk, to become an aerialist, to put your head in the lion's mouth. Learning is a death-defying act. And though it takes place largely within the confines of silent classrooms and sterile learning management systems, within the mind of the learner, riots can occur. Take, for instance, Frederick Douglass. As I writhed under it, I would at times feel that learning to read had been a curse rather than a blessing. It had given me a view of my wretched condition without the remedy. It opened my eyes to the horrible pit, but to no ladder upon which to get out. In moments of agony, I envied my fellow slaves for their stupidity. I have often wished myself a beast. I preferred the condition of the meanest reptile to my own, anything, no matter what, to get rid of thinking. We need to remind ourselves that learning is the single most important act in human life, and to treat it ever so lightly through conversations about objectives and outcomes and alignment, and for goodness sakes, educational psychology, to entrench it within a discourse permeable only to the institutionally educated is not just to do it a disservice, but it is to reduce it so far that passion, drive, need are all emptied from it. How could we scaffold the learning Frederick Douglass did? What objectives would we set before him? What outcomes would we expect? By the end of this course, you will give tongue to interesting thoughts of your own soul. Gain from dialogue the power of truth. Abhor and detest your enslavers. Understand how the silver trump, sorry about that, of freedom rouses the soul. Funny, right? But these should be the concerns of a critical instructional design. That's my dog. I want to thank you for listening to me. I'm not an experienced keynote speaker. I'm not a professor. I have no PhD. But because I look like I do, people quiet to hear what I say. With this gray beard of mine, I am the institution. I am the LMS. I may be gay, but I can pass as someone who carries all the cards of privilege. And privilege is authority. It is a podium. And when each of us steps behind any podium, we are positioned to be listened to. When really we need to be listening. It's difficult, I admit, to go through 20 plus years of education, listening and listening to the person at the front of the room, only to be told by all us well-meaning pedagogues that listening is also the key to teaching, making space for others to speak, making space for invention, for back channels, for tangents. It sort of sucks. When will we get to speak? The answer doesn't lie in turn-taking, but in changing what it means to speak. Make speaking a collaborative event. Join your voice with the voice of students. Join your voice with the voice of other teachers. Join your voice, and this one is actually really essential if we're going to make any headway. Join your voice with the voices of educational technology. Anne-Marie Perez wrote in her teaching statement, which she posted on her blog this morning, "There are not enough voices engaged in Chicano Chicana studies in this university or this state, in this country, in this world. Our artists, our people are under attack, and it has pretty much ever been so. Yet there is so much that is significant in the Chicano thought that literature, art, and in our own lives, in literature, art, and in our own lives. I teach what I do the way I do because I want us to see and talk about it together. I want my classes to add to and be part of this collection, to hear the voices from our past and amplify them. I want your voices to be amplified, your word to be read, your art to be seen. That's a pretty good teaching statement. I would agree. There are not enough Chicana voices. There are not enough Black voices. There are not enough First Nation voices. There are not enough trans voices. There are not enough women's voices. There are not enough queer voices. We need to change our minds about speaking as coming from a single mouth, a single amplified signal. We must learn to hear the patterns in the noise. And we probably shouldn't call it noise anymore. All those blogs, all those domains of their own, all those sites where educators get angry or get sad or begin the long path toward empathy. Do we need single voices to rise above the others? Do we need keynote speakers? Do we still need podiums at all? Let's build an education where professors and their lookalikes, old white men with gray beards, listen more, and women, people of color, trans folk, and others whose voices and wisdom have been omitted for so long become our collaborators. Let's design that classroom, that learning experience. Let's make that the world we occupy. Thank you.
Start with a moment for questions for Sean or responses, and then we'll bring Martha back for a little bit of joint Q&A.
I'll start with a statement as well. We do need keynotes like this because they frame things. So other things can happen outside. Mm. So that's all.
Uh-oh, my boss has a question.
She's going to give you a statement.
I'm going to pull an Audrey Waters and say, Sean, you're my hero. Aww. Thank you.
I'm going to ask the how question.
And I'm going to ask to get right back to you. Because there are people who are on the ground figuring this out, right? And I think that there aren't answers right now. The important thing actually right now is that we continue asking the right questions. And I think I think that we get stuck in the how. I think that we start thinking about that. And it's like throwing a party. Because teaching is always like throwing a party. I learned that from Jesse, actually. I wasn't being sarcastic. Teaching is like throwing a party. And it's like throwing a party, but you don't exactly know who the guests are gonna be. And so you get kind of nervous and, oh, I didn't make anything gluten-free, you know, like they did here. And it's like, are people gonna be happy? Are people gonna be okay? How am I gonna talk to people I don't know? This is a huge concern for an introvert, right? Whenever I have a party. But you figure it out in the moment because you go into it with the intention of being hospitable to everyone. And so you figure it out. And I think that right now, that's the only answer there is to go into it with the right intention. To be thinking about these things when you're writing your syllabus, when you're writing your teaching statement, when you're writing a lesson plan, when you're writing a quiz, for Christ's sakes, excuse me. I think that you have to have these things in mind all the time. And you may find when you sit down to write a quiz, for example, and you have these ideas in your head, that you realize there's no way to write that quiz. And so you need something else. And so you figure out something else. We can't just assume, and that was what Papert's quote was all about, we can't just assume that school's way is the only way. In fact, there was a point, and Kathy Davidson pointed this out earlier, that there was a point at which all of this stuff that we think is school wasn't school, and it wasn't that long ago. So it can change again. Just has to take people to do it.
Hi.
Hi.
So I actually... Let's see, how can I word this? Okay, for many years, I have tried to be a part of academia and, you know, find a job, and, you know, that didn't work, so I'm working for a giant corporation now.
Mm-hmm. I've been there.
Yeah. So I'm sort of unlearning the unlearning.
Mm-hmm.
How do you, I mean, really, we're... You know, like, how many of you use Internet Explorer on your computers? I have to use Internet Explorer at work. Like, I have to...
I'm so sorry.
Yeah, we're using really old systems. And I'm thinking of, you know, Martha as well, and the things that she was saying. Like, we are in boxes. We are the dogs. They want us to... memorize things. I mean, right now I'm having trouble keeping up with people that are 10 years younger than me, because I'm pretty sure they're better at memorizing things instead of thinking on their own. There are things where I am saying, why are we doing it this way? Wouldn't it make more sense? Well, it doesn't matter, because that's not the way we do it. How does that, I'm having a hard time, like, in the real world. How do I coexist with, like, all this stuff? Because I've grown up with this stuff in the past 10 years and not the normal, or what we think of as mm-hmm. normal stuff.
Yeah.
Like, how do you, I mean, it's really disconcerting. I'm going to work after this. How do you go back and forth? How do you make those two ways of living coexist for students? Because this is great, I love this, but it's not always the way it's gonna work.
So I would say, and actually Amy and I talk about this a lot in our work at Middlebury, that this is a long game. For a while, last year, I was living with a 19-year-old, and not my own kid, but someone else. and you know, every weekend, life is short, life is short, life is short, and me from the background, no, life is long. trust me, you're going to change your mind so many times. And I think that's true with these sorts of goals. I think this is true. Like, this is going to take a long time, and it takes persistence, and it takes stamina, and it takes always asking, always engaging in this discussion, no matter what, no matter how awkward or painful. I worked for Instructure, the makers of the Canvas LMS, for a year before Amy saved me. And I actually didn't mind working for Instructure, right? They had great benefits, and they were really up and cheerful, and they provided tons of swag, and it was really fun.
That's exactly and, what my job is.
Yeah, and so it's cool and all, and my boss was great, because he would let me engage in these conversations with him, and then he would say, "I really understand where you're coming from, and that's not what we can do right now." But he never sort of let go of the idea that maybe one day. And so there was someone I could at least converse with. And then I would say the other thing that has kept me going is Digital Pedagogy Lab, and the work that I've done with Hybrid Pedagogy and Digital Pedagogy Lab, and the amazing people that I work with, the amazing teachers that are here this year. Finding that community is so vital, finding support for the work that you really want to do. And then just sticking to your guns, no matter how awkward and weird it might get, and recognizing in the end, this is real life. What we're talking about, this is real life. And it will eventually be uncovered.
On that note, I'm actually going to invite Martha back down so that we can have a few more questions with the two of you. And as Martha is coming down the stairs, I have a first question for the two of you.
Okay.
Sean and I have done a thought experiment where we wrote a piece together, and I think we told the intro track this. We wrote a piece together called "If Frere Made a MOOC." And then now we have our unwritten article, which is the sequel to that, which we have bandied about. And the title of the unwritten article is "If Bell Hooks Made a Learning Management System." And so my first question that I want to ask to Martha and Sean is essentially, what learning management system would Bell Hooks build? Essentially, I want to know if the two of you can speak to how some of the stuff Sean ended with weaves back into the sort of beginning, the starting of, okay, where do we start to do this kind of work?
You should probably start that answer, because reasons.
So that's fine. I'll start the answer because it's going to quickly pass to you, because I actually think the domain of one's own is getting there.
Yeah.
I think that's exactly where we're headed with that. I think that is kind of an LMS that Bell Hooks might at least bless. So,
and I'm going to throw the question back at you, because I actually hate questions like this. No offense, Jesse, but I think you probably know that. So for years, I've heard the question of, well, is WordPress the LMS killer? And is open source as good? And I hate it, because I think it frames this false dichotomy, and it pushes us into framing our responses as though the LMS is the thing that we are trying to do, instead of saying, what are we trying to do? And then let's find and explore and use technologies that help us enact that. So I'm fine with the LMS as a place where you post your grades. And I'm fine with the LMS as a place that easily allows you to email your students. And if you really love PDFs, and you need a way to distribute them to a group of people, then use your LMS. I mean, Dropbox is nice too, but fine. Use your LMS. But the point at which the LMS, we're framing our conversation in response to the LMS about how we teach using technology, we have lost our way. Mm-hmm. And so I would hope Bell Hooks would say, screw the LMS, let's do domain of one's own, let's do something else, let's think together and learn together, and most importantly, let's sit together, and let's define our values, and let's think about what matters to us and our beliefs, and then let's talk about where that takes us. Mm-hmm.
So I've got a follow-up question to that, because while you were talking, you mentioned the loss of control that comes with opening space up for students to be able to use their voice on the web. And I recognize that from the teacher perspective, mm-hmm. but I think what you're saying here, and what you just presented as an answer, is an opportunity for an entire institution to lose control, to voluntarily give up control, to recognize that having students control things is actually more in their best interest than maintaining centralized control. And I'm asking this question knowing that we're streaming live on the web, and Jeff from my institution can see this, and he's the guy who wants control. Do you have a suggestion or a perspective that, because I know a lot of the folks in the audience here are not administrators. A lot of us are more, you know, trenches, teacher people. Is there a perspective that we could adopt, or a banner that we could carry across our campus to try and get that lack of control?
So a couple of responses to that, one of which I will echo what Sean just said, which is that this is a long game. And I, while I might be a revolutionary at heart, work at an institution, and I get paid a really nice salary, and I get good benefits, and I am part of a state system. And I recognize that none of us can snap our fingers, or even collectively snap our fingers, and the institution is suddenly going to say, screw all that. Let's change it all. Let's give up control. But that said, I also believe that we have seen the enemy and it is us. And I say that meaning that we are where we are because we did not speak up and we did not use our voices. And that is our responsibility as well. And I've worked for lots of great administrators who understand these issues, but they also need lots of great faculty and lots of great instructional technologists and lots of great librarians and lots of great students who are also saying these things and repeating these things and asking for these things and asking ourselves to be critical and to speak critically, I think, is where we start. And I don't think we use our voices nearly enough.
I would agree with everything she just said. And all of a sudden, I realized why Jesse put us together. It's very Machiavellian of you. What do you think I've been doing for 4.5 years?
Very sensitive.
Thanks, Chris. Okay, just a very quick question. This was wonderful in talking about coming together with our students and sharing voices and the domain of one's own. I'm a teacher. Everybody here who teaches will also have Trump supporters in the class wanting to build their domains. That's true. We all know that's true.
I know.
So what is it? How do we move away from assumptions about liberal community in this?
Well, because the reason I sigh so heavily is because the unfortunate answer is that even people who support Trump deserve their own domain. It's really hard to say, but it's absolutely true. And I don't think that we don't limit who we teach. And everyone deserves access to education, and hopefully with education to learn better. But it's true. It takes all kinds. My husband's grandmother is fond of saying, and it's absolutely true. We can't. There are voices we need to privilege because they've been silent for too long. Those are not Trump supporter voices. They have not been silent in history. Okay, so there are voices we need to privilege, but we can't just go around silencing everybody anymore because that's just bad behavior. And it's not pedagogical. Martha, do you have a different?
No, what you said. Okay. Wait, but you're going to call time soon, and there's one other thing I have to do, say, though, because my mom and dad are watching, and I was supposed to say hi to them. Hi, Mom and Dad. Sorry.
Okay, actually, that was a really great note to end on. So I'm going to end there, and we are happy. So we have 15 more minutes to get some more coffee, to come and chat with Sean and Martha, and then people who are here for the Institute back in your tracks at 10:45. 15 minutes.
And as a housekeeping note, please be courteous to take everything with you from where you're sitting. Just look around for a second to make sure we can more efficiently turn the space over. Thanks.